Gospel of Luke, chapter number 16. We'll read one verse this morning. We'll read verse number 19. The Bible says, "There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your blessings. Lord, you've been so good to us. Lord, our hearts have been made rejoiced from the good congregational singing, the good choir singing, and the good special singing, the good testimony. God, we could leave right now and say we were blessed, Lord, for being in the house of God. Then add to that the good news of the 22 people saved over at the jail this morning. What a blessing. God, we're thankful for that open door. We're thankful you still love sinners. You're still willing to save to the uttermost. And God, I realize that they're not only sinners at the jailhouse, they're even sinners that come to the church house. And God, I'm glad that you love the church and gave yourself for it. Lord, you've got a place where even sinners can come and hear the good news that Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Now, Father, Lord, even though we could leave, say it's been good. Lord, in my heart, I know your business isn't done. Lord, I realize that, God, before we ever was, you knew this day would come. And you knew what would befall us, and you knew what we would need. God, you know the number of the hairs on every head in this building, and you knew who would be here this morning. And so, Father, I pray that, Lord, your blessing would not stop, but it would just start to begin. And God, I pray you'd put a hedge about us. I plead the blood of the darling Son of God, the Lord Jesus, over this place. I pray that the saints of God's hearts would be knit together in unity. I pray you would revive us. God, you would change us and transform us for thy glory. God, I pray for any amongst us who may be unsaved, that today the scales would fall off their eyes, more importantly, the eyes of their heart, that they might see the need of a Savior. Now, Father, I pray that you'd help us. Lord, you'd rest our attention. Lord, you'd speak to our hearts. Lord, you'd glorify your name. Lord, we thank you for being so merciful and so gracious. And we thank you in advance for what you're going to do. Use this unworthy vessel. We'll bless you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Since Thursday, I've had the fellow in our text on my heart. I've mused over him, Brother James, and I've meditated on him, and I've thought of him. Yesterday, we had to go down to Sydney School for orientation. The hours that I drove going and coming, and my mind was on this fella in this text. There's not a place I've been since Thursday that he has not been with me. In all of my meditating and thinking, I knew the Lord would have me to say something about this fella. And last night, the Lord began to reveal unto me the message for the hour. And yes, we had a little rough morning, and it did not catch me by surprise, because every time the Lord bids me to preach along the lines we'll be preaching this morning, the powers of hell hate it. The powers of hell and the ruler of hell works expeditiously and tirelessly to blind people from the truths that will be revealed today. Amen. And I want you to think with me on this fellow of our text. I want you to notice this man's focus. The Bible says that there was a certain rich man which was clothed and purple and fine linen. Can I say this man's focus was not on eternity? This man's focus was on the pleasures of this world and the riches of this world. Can I say, from the world's perspective, this man was successful. This man lived his dream. This man obtained riches and wealth. This man was clothed in fine linen. Brother Tommy, this man didn't shop at Walmart. This man had a fella come to him and make clothes to fit him. They were of the finest of materials. He lived in the greatest of realms. He was looked upon and aspired to be liked because of all that he had and all that he had focused his life around. Can I say, there are a lot of people today, they may not have the world's riches. They may not be wearing the world's greatest clothing, but they have the same focus this man has. Their focus is on themselves and their lives and a better life, and obtaining all that they can from this world's goods, obtaining all that they can from this world's perspective, and to have other people aspire to be like them. We see his focus. I want you to notice this fellow's faring. Look what it says again in our text. There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. That word sumptuously means lavishly. Can I say, this man, according to the Bible, he fared sumptuously every day. He lived a lavish lifestyle every day. Now, can I say, a few weeks ago, we went on that cruise, and the good thing about being on a cruise, you're on there with everybody else, and they look at you like you're living lavishly, and you are. I mean, it's lobster and steak every day. I mean, you're looking like you somebody. Then reality hits when you come down that gangplank to get off that ship. You got to go back to plastic forks and paper plates. Are you listening to me? But this man lived lavishly every day. I mean, he had plated silverware. He had china that he ate off of. He had the finest of food brought to him. I mean, he had the finest of chariots to ride in. He had servants galore. I mean, he lived lavishly every single day. There's nobody in this building that's lived one day like this guy lived every day. We see his focus. We see his faring. But I couldn't help in my meditation on this man, Miss Marcy, of looking at his fate. Look at verse 23. Verse 22 concludes, this rich man also died and was buried, and his fate's found in verse 23. And in hell he lift up his eyes. Jesus, in another portion, talked about what would it profit a man if he gained the whole world and lost his own soul. Can I say, there's nothing wrong with being rich? It's the love of money that is the root of all evil. There's nothing wrong with faring well, unless your faring well doesn't get you to the well, the well of living water. Can I say, his focus and his faring so dictated his life, he didn't think about his fate. Can I say, if the Lord Jesus doesn't come back from for his church, everyone in this building one day is going to die. Can I say, it doesn't matter once you die whether you ate off of paper plates or whether you ate off of china. What matters is what you did with Jesus Christ. I got to thinking about this man's fate. Oh, he fared so well. He lived so lavishly. But when he took his last breath, that was all over. Can I say, in hell he was tormented. He had servants in this life, but in the afterlife he was tormented. There was none to come to his aid. The Bible says in verse 23, and in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeing Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I'm tormented in this flame. He mentions twice how he's tormented, and he's looking for somebody to come to his aid. He cries for mercy, yet there is no mercy in hell, and he cries for someone to come and aid him and cool his tongue, but there is no comforts in hell. He's tormented. Every breath in hell is a gulf of flame. The Bible describes hell as a place of fire and brimstone. Brimstone is a smell that is so grotesque that it wants you to regurgitate, and the very scent of hell causes you to gag, but you cannot regurgitate because the fluid would comfort your tormented tongue. Gagging, tormented, endless, non-helpful, eternal punishment. Can I say the torment deals with his physical anguish? But he was not only tormented, he was tortured. Look at verse 25. Then Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receiveth thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And besides all this, between us and you there's a great gulf fixed, so that they which pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. He's tortured, and he's tortured with the first thing that Abraham tells him. He says, Son, remember. He's tortured with the remembrance. He's tortured with every time that he remembers when his mother took him to the temple and told him to keep the commandments and put his faith in God. He's remembering every time that he heard that Jesus was on the scene and Jesus told him, hey, sell what thou hast and give to the poor. He's remembering all the opportunities that he had to trust in the Lord, but he's tortured with every moment in hell at the thought that he rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. The torturing shows his mental anguish. He's not only tormented, he's not only tortured, but in hell he's traumatized. Look at verse 27. When he realizes there's no hope for him and there's no escape for him, look where his attention turns. And then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto them, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. I said, he's traumatized. He's traumatized because he knows he didn't live a life that would cause his brothers to escape this place. He's traumatized because he knows the life that his brothers are living. And he's traumatized with the very thought that his family members are going to end up in the same place of torture and torment as him. Amen. This is heartfelt anguish. Can I say, even people in hell don't want other people to end up in hell. Abraham says they've got Moses and the prophets. He said, no, though one, send one from the dead. He said, they won't hear them. No one won't hear one that rose from the dead. Can I help you with something? Jesus did raise from the dead. But if you don't put your faith in what God said, you'll never believe on him that rose from the dead. And in all my thinking about this fella, his focus, his faring, his fate, his torment, his torture, and his trauma, I want to preach on this morning. I want to preach on how to avoid going to hell. How to avoid going to hell. Can I say this man is still in hell today? But if he just heard the title of the message, you know what he said? Amen. Tell him, preacher. There's nobody exhorting the preacher any more than this rich man in hell. He's saying, tell him not to come here. I want to preach again on how to avoid going to hell. Can I say, first of all, you can avoid going to hell by realizing that you're a sinner. The Bible says in Isaiah 59:2, and I'm just going to preach the word this morning. The Bible says in Isaiah 59:2, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. Ecclesiastes 7:20 says, for there is not a just man upon the earth that doeth good and sinneth not. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death. Adam and Eve chose to sin, and because they did, sin has been passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. You were conceived in iniquity, and in sin did your mother bring you forth. You was born a sinner. You sin by practice. You sin by nature. You sin by choice. You're a sinner. You're a addicted to sin. You can't stop sinning on your own. The greatest day in your life is to realize you're a sinner. You'll never get help trying to justify your sin. You'll never get help trying to excuse away your sin. The problem with our world today is people don't want to put the blame where the blame lies. The devil doesn't make us do it. We do it ourselves willingly and openly. It'll be a great day in your life, and you can avoid hell when you start realizing you're a sinner. It's not your mama's problem. It's not your daddy's problem. It's not because somebody didn't love you. Not because you were bullied. Not because you was introduced to something. Not because of you just wasn't loved like you should have been loved. Friend, you're a sinner. But you don't have to go to hell. Can I say? God loves sinners. Hate sin, but love sinners. How can I avoid going to hell, preacher? First of all, by realizing you're a sinner. Can I say, secondly, by recognizing there's a Savior. There's a way out. The Bible says Jesus came seeking to save that which was lost. What's he talking about, lost? I'm not lost. I'm here today. If you're sinful, then you're lost from God. Listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says in 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also hath suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. Do you realize there was a Savior? There was somebody who took your place. There was somebody who took your sin. There's somebody who took all the law that was against you. And he took it and he paid for it so you, my friend, might have a pardon from God. The Bible says in Romans 5:8, but God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. Can I say, Jesus just didn't die for the good because there was none good. Amen. He died for sinners. And then can I say, God loved you even though you were and are a sinner. He loves you. Can I say, by the good grace of God, you're not already in hell? Can I say, by the good grace of God, he allowed you to be here today and hear this message because he don't want you to die and go to hell. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:3-4, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. That is the gospel. That is the good news. There's good news, sinners. Christ died for you. He just didn't happen to get crucified. No, he came into this world to die according to the Scriptures. It was prophesied he'd die on the cross. He died according to Scriptures. He was buried, and he did raise again under his own power, conquering death, hell, and the grave. Conquering sin and dominion, that you and I might be forgiven of our sins. The Bible says in John 14:6, Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. There's only one way to heaven. It's not a Baptist way. It's a Bible way. Yeah. And I say, His name is Jesus. Yeah. Sure. Only one way to heaven. Right. It's through Him. The Bible says in Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Right. Can I say? The Catholic Church teaches that salvation's in the church. Hogwash. Mm. Salvation's in Christ. Right. You can do everything the Catholics say to do, and you can do it to the letter of their law, and you'll die and go to hell, and you'll be right here next to this rich man. Sure. I'm sure he had a priest or two tell him how good he was because of all the money he gave. Uh-huh. Mm. I'm sure he had a priest or two overlook his faults and his failure and his sin because of what he was doing for the priest. Can I say salvation is not what we can do for God, but what God was willing to do for you and I? Amen. The Bible again in Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but that's not where the verse ends. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You can't earn it. It's a gift from God. Can I say you could never be good enough to get God's approval? You could never be holy enough to get God's approval. Why? Because you were tainted with sin. That's why God sent His Son, His only begotten Son, who was holy, to shed His royal redeeming blood for you and I, that we might be saved. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission for sins. Can I say how you can avoid hell? First of all, you got to realize you're a sinner. Second of all, you got to recognize there's a Savior. But then third of all, you got to receive Him by faith. Again, everybody knows John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You just don't have to believe that He was. You got to believe in Him. You got to put your faith in Him. You got to realize you can't get saved on your own. So you've got to believe in Him who'll save you. The Bible says in John 1:12, but as many as received Him or believed in Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name. Romans 10:9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Amen. Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You got to receive Him by faith. You got to not only believe that He is, but that He is willing to save you if you'll come to Him. You've got to give up the rights to your own salvation and throw yourself on His mercy. Amen. And believe that He'll save you according to His word. Preacher, how can I avoid going to hell? You got to realize you're a sinner. You got to recognize there's a Savior. You got to receive Him by faith. But then can I say this? You've got to repent of your sins. Yes, sir. So there's a lot of people say, I believe in God, but they never repent. Can I say the Bible says in the book of James that the devils believe and they fear and tremble. Right. There's nobody believes in Jesus Christ more than Satan.
Right. That's good. Amen. Yeah.
Believing in Him isn't enough. We've raised three generations of people who say, I believe in Jesus, only to see them die and go to hell because they've never repented.
Amen.
You see, when you repent, there's a change happens.
Right. Yeah.
Your life changes. The Bible says this about repentance. Acts 17:30 says, and the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. You're never going to escape hell and avoid it unless you repent. The Bible says in Luke 13:3, Jesus said, I tell you nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Well, what is repentance? Let me show you the Bible definition of repentance. Acts 11:21, and the hand of the Lord was with them. God's been here today. The Bible says, and a great number believed. Hallelujah, they believed. But see, that's not enough. Here it is. And turned unto the Lord. Repentance is a turning. Turning from your ways to His way. turning from your thoughts and your ideals of what it takes to get to heaven to turning to Him. Turning from your works and your good deeds and the money you give and the time you go to church and all the prayers you pray. Turning from that and turning to Him and throwing yourself on His mercy and what He did and not what you did. There's a lot of people say they believe in Jesus, but when you ask them to tell you how they got saved, all they'll talk about, whoa, I started believing in Him. I got baptized. I started going to church. But they never talk about turning from their sin. You know why some of you can't be faithful? You know why some of you can't read your Bible? You know why some of you, when you pray, it's just idle words that don't even reach the ceiling? You wonder why the blessings of God spiritually are not in your life? How you can come to church and folks hear singing and start rejoicing and you sit there numb? You sit there like a knot on a log? You see other people get excited and you wonder why aren't you excited? Why you can't get excited like them? It just may be, friends. And you've never repented. There's no change in your life. If you ever realize that you was a sinner and God sent a Savior, it's more than believing. And you repent and accept Him and He changes you. You don't easily get over that. Hey, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. Hey, I once was headed to hell. Now I'm heaven bound. Why? Because of what Jesus did when He said, save me. Reason some of you can't quit sinning is because there's never been a change. You've never repented. Listen, I can go all over this building and start asking people to stand up, and they'll tell you they used to be a church member, but God revealed to them they's lost. They believed in Jesus, they just hadn't believed on Him. They hadn't repented and said, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Can I say, the day under Holy Ghost conviction, when they called on Jesus and repented, there was a change, and they've never been the same. Can I say, it's terrible that this rich man died and went to hell. You know what's more terrible? People sitting on a Baptist church pew dying and going to hell.
You're right. Amen.
Where the truth is being preached. I believe, Brother Doug, I believe. But have you repented? Is there a change? Let me help you something. The Bible says the spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. Can I help you something? The flesh cannot live a Christian life. You know why some of you get mad when I start preaching on issues? Because you need to repent. Now listen, I've been saved 44 years. And I'm not going to tell you that there's preachers who haven't made me mad when they're preaching. I tell you the two times I've been mad when I've heard a preacher preach. Number one, I get mad when I hear a preacher preach and he's not preaching the Bible. That makes me mad. I can call out my Aunt Lynn back there and talk about a camp meeting we was at where the preacher was talking about if your wife doesn't do what you say, punch her in the face. That's not Bible. I got mad. So what happened? I left the meeting. I wasn't going to sit under that junk. That's not Bible preaching. I have no room for non-Bible preaching. And when somebody takes up God's time and they're not preaching the Bible, that makes me mad. Amen. You know when else I get mad? When I've been mad when there's been preaching? When I wasn't right with God. And that preacher was preaching on my sin. But happy day when I realized I better give it to God. And now a preacher can preach. And if he sits in my lap and nails my toes to the floor, I'm shouting the victory because God loves me so much that He's willing to send a man of God to preach and tell me I'm wrong. Amen. You see, you'll never repent till you realize you're wrong.
Amen.
Some of you are seeking the world's gratification. You're seeking the world's acceptance. You're seeking to hang on with Jesus when you want to with one hand and still hang on the world and do what feels good. You know what your problem is? You need to repent. Jesus said you can't have two masters. You'll love one, hate the other. Some of you try to act spiritual, but the reason you're not spiritual is you need to repent. Say, preacher, you trying to get me to doubt my salvation? I'm not trying to do anything but preach the Bible. But I'm here to tell you, if you aren't feeling the Holy Ghost bubble up in your soul, you need to repent. Either you're lost or you're out of the will of God. Amazes me. I can preach on faithfulness till the cows come home, and it doesn't bother some of you. You know why? You need to repent.
Amen.
While I'm preaching on faithfulness, I'm asking God to forgive me, because I know I could be more faithful than I am. Brother Mercer said, pray for me. I need to be a better Christian. While he's doing it, I'm asking God to forgive me. He said, God, I need to be a better Christian.
Right. Amen.
But some of you come to church and you never get bothered. You know why? Because you never open up your heart to the fact you need to repent. See, you'll never avoid hell till you realize you're a sinner. And some of you sitting here may be lost, and you try to talk yourself into being saved. Can I help you something? It don't work. Because you always know something's missing. Brother Bob, you sit in the church house lost. You try to talk yourself into it, huh? Wasn't it a good day when you repented? Wonderful day. Huh? You used to carry that thing in your paper, how far it is from heaven to hell is about this far, isn't it? Huh? In your head you believe, but your heart you haven't believed because you haven't repented. And I didn't mean to spend this much time on this, but some of you are really, really revolting in your spirit right now. Some of you are sitting there thinking, oh, get off of that point, get off of that point. And God's saying, just hammer it home more, son. They need to repent. You know what happens when you repent? All things become new. Old things are passed away. I don't have to act like a Christian, because when I repented, I became one. I don't have to act spiritual. When I repent, I am spiritual. Can I say this? They believed and turned unto the Lord. I'm glad you believe that Jesus was the Son of God. Have you ever repented and turned to Him? Romans 10:10 says this, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the Scripture saith, whosoever believeth on Him shall not be ashamed.
Right.
See, those that repent, they're not ashamed of Him. Those that have repented, when she sang that song, I pledge allegiance to the Lamb, they say, yep, me too, hallelujah, that's my Savior. But those that say they're saved, but they're ashamed to come up and embarrassed to come up front of the church and say, I just got saved. Those that are ashamed to get in the baptismal pool. Those that are ashamed to give out gospel tracts and invite folks to church. Those that don't live a life that shines, a life of light and salt, because you're afraid of what the world thinks. You need to repent. The Bible says that if you repent, you won't be ashamed of Him. And He said, if you're ashamed of me before men, I'll be ashamed of you before my Father, my dear friends.
Right.
If you're ashamed to let people know you believe in Jesus, you might need to repent. Can I help you something? If you repent and know Jesus, you can't help but let people know, because your life tells on you. You know why I don't go to bars? Because I'm a Christian.
Amen.
Folks that say, hey, you want to go get a drink? I say, no. They say, oh, that's right, you're a Christian.
Yeah,
right. Yep, guilty.
Yeah.
Hey. You know why I want to look different? Because I'm not of this world.
Right.
Yeah.
That's good, Pastor.
My citizenship's in heaven.
Yeah.
I want to be like Him. You realize He became like us that He might redeem us, that we could become like Him?
Right.
And when you repent, you have a desire to be like Him.
Sure.
Mm-mm. Well, the latest fad, you know what the latest fad is in heaven? Look like Jesus.
Yeah.
Walk like Jesus.
Oh, yeah.
Talk like Jesus.
Yeah.
Act like Jesus.
Yeah.
Go where Jesus goes.
Hey.
Do what Jesus does. Huh? Get a burden like Jesus had a burden. Just be like Jesus. That's what's popular in heaven.
Sure.
How come Christians want to be like the world? Because they're not Christian. To be Christian is to be Christ-like.
Right.
You know, can I say there's nobody got a halo, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't work for one. I want my whole life to be a life that's clean and holy before God. Don't always meet that, but I desire it. You avoid hell by realizing you're a sinner, by recognizing there's a Savior. by receiving Him by faith, and then by repenting of your sins. You know what happens then? You'll be raised in newness of life. Jesus said that the thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. I'm come that you might have life and might have it more abundantly.
Amen.
Ephesians 2:1 says, "And you hath he quickened," or made alive, "who were dead in trespasses and sins." People that aren't saved, they're dead in sin. They're dead to God. They're of no use to God because their life denies Him. Their actions deny Him. They're breathing His air and don't stop to give Him the glory for it. If you're saved today, you once were dead in sins. You know what I'm talking about. But when you got sealed by the Holy Spirit of promise, something happened. You got quickened. You were made alive. The spiritual scales fell off your eyes and you saw things in a new light because you believed and repented of your sins. And I say this, Romans 6:4, "Therefore we are buried with Him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life."
Amen.
You know why you walk different when you're saved? Because you've been raised in newness of life. Preachers shouldn't have to preach a bunch of rules what it takes to be saved. The Holy Ghost should already speak it in your heart when you're reading the Bible. And the reason you don't follow the rules of the Holy Ghost is you don't know Him. Either that or you certainly quench and grieve Him out of your life, which again means you got sin in your life because the Bible says grieve not the Holy Spirit. Romans 6:11 says, "Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord." Friend, you don't have to go to hell. Jesus came and took your hell, and He paid for your sins, and He's willing to forgive you of your sins if you're willing to not only put your faith in Him, but repent and ask Him to save you. He said if any come to Him, He'd nowise cast them out. The Bible says that today is the day of salvation, not to harden your hearts as in the day of provocation. You could be saved today, but you've got to realize you're a sinner. Recognize there's a Savior. You got to receive Him by faith, but then repent of your sins. Then He'll do for you what you can't do for yourself. He'll save your soul, and He'll raise you in newness of life. If you're here today and you're saved, you ought to have a burden for sinners. This rich man, you ought to meditate on him like I have the last 3 days. What a waste. How much good could he have done for God if he'd used all that God blessed him with for other people not to die and go to hell? It was all in vain. If you're here today and you're saved, you ought to be burdened for sinners. You ought to have a desire to see folks saved. You ought to be broken for these folks every Wednesday night that ask us to pray for their lost loved ones. You ought to be broken for folks that used to come to church faithfully, but they've let sin enter their life and they don't come to church faithfully anymore. You ought to have a burden for sinners. And I promise you this, God did not have me preach this message this morning without sinners being here. You ought to be broken. Ask for the Holy Ghost of God through cords of love to draw sinners unto repentance. You may be here today and you believe, but you've never truly repented. You know how I can tell and how you can tell you've never repented? There's never been a change in your life. There's never been a change. You still are the Lord of your life and you try to please God in your ways. And you'll never do it, friend. Don't end up in hell with this fella. Remember when I said he was tortured by the remembrance? If you die and go to hell, you'll remember this message. You'll see my ugly face point my finger at you saying, "You need to repent, you need to repent, you need to repent." And you'll be in hell and you'll praise and worship God in hell because you know that God gave you an opportunity and you rejected Him. And you'll suffer in the charred region of the damned with the devil and his angels forever because you rejected the mercy and grace and love of God. Friend, you don't have to go to hell. You being here today ensures that God loves you and God's concerned about you. But you've got to be willing to come and repent of your sins. Say, "Preacher, I don't know how to be saved." Man, we're going to have an invitation. You come, we'll take the Bible and show you what the Bible says about being saved. You can be saved here today. But I've told you, you just need to realize you're a sinner and recognize that God sent the Savior. Receive Him by faith and repent of your sins and God will save you. Friend, if you're willing to receive Him, I promise you, He'll receive you. He's no respecter of persons. If he saved me, he'll save you.
Amen.
And he bids all to come. The last book of the Bible concludes with the Spirit says come, the bride says come, the Savior says come. But friend, it's up to you. You must come. Receive him by faith and repent of your sins. And if you're willing to do that, God will save you. I wouldn't hold to some religious experience. I'd put my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and repent. And then you can, my dear friends, bank all of heaven on that, because that's what the Bible says it takes to be saved. Are you willing to be saved today? Let's all stand. Brother Ray, come get a song of invitation. Folks already praying. Maybe folks up here praying for you, friend. Why don't you just come? Why don't you come? Say, preacher, I doubt my salvation. Why don't you come get it nailed down? You can leave out of here without that doubt anymore. You can leave out of here rejoicing, knowing that you have your sins forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ. While these folks are praying, they're picking out a song. Let's pray. Our Father, we sure do thank you for the Word of God. Lord, I thank you for letting me think about that fellow in hell. I hate that he's there. But Lord, I don't want to see anybody else die and go there. God, thank you for the message today. Lord, there's somebody here today that need to hear they could avoid going to hell. Lord, their time may be short. They may be on the fast track there, but they don't have to go. Jesus Christ came and died for them, was buried and rose again, established his church to preach the gospel so they could hear that they need to believe and repent and trust Christ and be saved from their sin. God, help them to come today. Oh, God, I pray the Holy Ghost of God would single them out. You said, no man come unto the Father except he be drawn. I pray the Holy Ghost draw them. Convict them of sin. Help them to feel so guilty and so dirty. But they have a desire to be clean. Help them to come, get washed in the precious blood of Jesus. God, I pray. You deal with hearts. Maybe there's saved folks here, but they're not living like saved folks. Help them to come and repent. Get right with God. Go out of here different than they came in. Having a burden for sinners. Not dying and going to hell. Let God speak to hearts. Have your way in this invitation. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.